Chapter 42 Baba's Passing Away. Previous indication: averting death of Ramachandra Dada Patil and Tatya Kote Patil. Charity to Laxmibai Shinde. Last moment. This chapter describes the passing away of Baba. Preliminary: the stories given in the previous chapter have shown that the light of Guru's grace removes out fear of the mundane existence, opens the path of salvation, and turns our misery into happiness. If we always remember the feet of the Sadguru, our troubles come to an end, death loses its sting, and the misery of this mundane existence is obliterated. Therefore, those who care for their welfare should carefully listen to these stories of Sai Samarth, which will purify their minds. In the beginning, Hemant Pant dwells on Dr. Pandit's worship and is marking Baba's forehead with Tripundra. This is three horizontal lines, but as this has already been described in chapter 11, this has been omitted here. Previous indication: the readers up till now heard the stories of Baba's life. Let them now hear attentively Baba's passing away. Baba got a slight attack of fever on 28th September 1918. The fever lasted for 2 or 3 days, but afterwards Baba gave up his food and thereby he grew weaker and weaker. On the 17th day, this is Tuesday the 15th October 1918, Baba left his mortal coil at about 2:30 p.m. White Professor G.G. Narke's letter dated 5th November 1918 to Dada Sahib Kaparde, published in Sai Leela magazine, page 78, first year. 2 years before this, in 1916, Baba gave an indication of his passing away, but nobody understood it then. On the Vijayadashmi Dasara day, Baba at once got into a wild rage in the evening when people were returning from Simulangan, crossing the border or limits of the village. Taking off his headdress, kafni and langota, etc., he tore them and threw them into the duni before him. Fed by this offering, the fire in the duni began to burn brighter and Baba shone still brighter. He stood there, stark naked, and with his burning red eyes shouted, "You fellows, now have a look and decide finally whether I am a Muslim or a Hindu." Everybody was trembling with fear and none dared to approach Baba. After some time, Bagoji Shinde, the leper devotee of Baba, went boldly near him and succeeded in tying a langota, a waistband, round his waist and said, "Baba, what is all this? Today is the Simulangan, Dasara holiday." Baba, striking the ground with his satka, said, "This is my Simulangan, crossing the border." Baba did not cool down till 11 p.m. and the people doubted whether the Chavadi procession would ever take place that night. After an hour, Baba resumed his normal condition and, dressing himself as usual, attended the Chavadi procession as described before. By this incident, Baba gave a suggestion that Dasara was the proper time for him to cross the border of life, but none understood its meaning. Baba gave also another indication as follows. Averting death of Ramachandra and Tatya Patil. Sometime after this, Ramachandra Patil became seriously ill. He suffered a lot. He tried all remedies, but finding no relief, despaired of his life and was waiting for the last moment. Then one midnight, Baba suddenly stood near his pillow. Patil held his feet and said, "I have lost all hopes of life. Please tell me definitely when I shall die." Merciful Baba said, "Don't be anxious. Your hundi, death warrant, has been withdrawn and you will soon recover. But I am afraid of Tatya Patil. He will pass away on Vijayadashmi of Shaka, 1840. This is 1918 AD. Do not divulge this to anybody, nor to him, for he will be terribly frightened." Ramachandra Dada got well, but he felt nervous about Tatya's life, for he knew that Baba's word was unalterable and that Tatya would breathe his last within 2 years. He kept the secret and told it to none but one Bala Shimpi, a tailor. Only these two persons, Ramachandra Dada and Bala Shimpi, were in fear and suspense regarding Tatya's life. Ramachandra Dada soon left his bed and was on his legs. Time passed quickly. The month of Bhadrapad of Shaka 1840, 1918 AD was ending and Ashwin was in sight. True to Baba's word, Tatya fell sick and was bedridden, and so he could not come for Baba's darshana. Baba was also down with fever. Tatya had full faith in Baba, and Baba in Lord Hari, who was his protector. Tatya's illness began to grow from bad to worse and he could not move at all, but always remembered Baba. The predicament of Baba began to grow equally worse. The day predicted, this is Vijayadashmi, was impending, and both Ramachandra Dada and Bala Shimpi were terribly frightened about Tatya, and with their bodies trembling and perspiring with fear, thought that as predicted by Baba, Tatya's end was near. Vijayadashmi dawned and Tatya's pulse began to beat very slow and he was expected to pass away shortly. But a curious thing happened. Tatya remained, his death was averted, and Baba passed away in his stead. It seemed as if there was an exchange. People said that Baba gave up his life for Tatya. Why he did so, he alone knows, as his ways are inscrutable. It seems, however, that in this incident, Baba gave a hint of his passing away, substituting Tatya's name for his. Next morning, 16th October, Baba appeared to Das Ganu at Pandharpur in his dream and said to him, "The masjid collapsed. All the oilmen and grocers of Shirdi teased me a lot, so I leave the place. I therefore came to inform you here. Please go there quickly and cover me with buckle flowers." Das Ganu got the information also from Shirdi letters. So he came to Shirdi with his disciples and started bhajan and kirtan and sang the Lord's name all through the day before Baba's samadhi, himself weaving a beautiful garland of flowers studded with Lord Hari's name. He placed it on Baba's samadhi and gave a mass feeding in Baba's name. Charity to Laxmibai. Dasara or Vijayadashmi is regarded by all the Hindus as the most auspicious time, and it is befitting that Baba should choose this time for his crossing the borderline. He was ailing some days before this, but he was ever conscious internally. Just before the last moment, he sat up erect without anybody's aid and looked better. People thought that the danger had passed off and he was getting well. He knew that he was to pass away soon and therefore he wanted to give some money as charity to Laxmibai Shinde. Baba pervading all creatures. This Laxmibai Shinde was a good and well-to-do woman. She was working in the masjid day and night. Except Bhagat Malsapati, Tatya and Laxmibai, none was allowed to step in the masjid at night. Once, while Baba was sitting in the masjid with Tatya in the evening, Laxmibai came and saluted Baba. The latter said to her, "Oh Laxmi, I am very hungry." Off she went saying, "Baba, wait a bit. I'll return immediately with bread." She did return with bread and vegetables and placed the same before Baba. He took it up and gave it to a dog. Laxmibai then asked, "What is this, Baba? I ran in haste, prepared bread with my own hands for you, and you threw it to a dog without eating a morsel of it. You gave me the trouble unnecessarily." Baba replied, "Why do you grieve for nothing? The appeasement of the dog's hunger is the same as mine. The dog has got a soul. The creatures may be different, but the hunger of all is the same, though some speak and others are dumb. Know for certain that he who feeds the hungry really serves me with food. Regard this as an axiomatic truth." This is an ordinary incident, but Baba thereby propounded a great spiritual truth and showed its practical application in daily life without hurting anybody's feelings. From this time onwards, Laxmibai began to offer him daily bread and milk with love and devotion. Baba accepted it and ate it appreciatingly. He took a part of this and sent the remainder with Laxmibai to Radha Krishna Mai, who always relished and ate Baba's remnant prasad. This bread story should not be considered as a digression. It shows how Sai Baba pervaded all the creatures and transcended them. He is omnipresent, birthless, deathless and immortal. Baba remembered Laxmibai's service. How could he forget her? Just before leaving the body, he put his hand in his pocket and gave her once ₹5, and again ₹4, in all ₹9. This figure 9 is indicative of the 9 types of devotion described in chapter 21, or it may be the dakshina offered at the time of Simulangan. Laxmibai was a well-to-do woman and so she was not in want of any money. So Baba might have suggested to her and brought prominently to her notice the 9 characteristics of a good disciple mentioned in the 6th verse of chapter 10. Skanda 11 of the Bhagavad, wherein first 5 and then 4 characteristics are mentioned in the first and second couplets. Baba followed the order, first paid ₹5 and then ₹4, in all ₹9. Not only 9, but many times 9 rupees passed through Laxmibai's hand, but Baba's this gift of 9, she will ever remember. Being so watchful and conscious, Baba also took other precautions in his last moment in order that he should not be embroiled or entangled with love and affection for his devotees. He ordered them all to clear off. Kaka Sahib Dikshit, Bapu Sahib Bhuti and others were in the masjid anxiously waiting upon Baba, but he asked them to go to the wada and return after meals. They could not leave Baba's presence, nor could they disobey him. So with heavy hearts and heavy feet, they went to the wada. They knew that Baba's case was very serious and that they could not forget him. They sat for meals, but their mind was elsewhere. It was with Baba. Before they finished, news came to them of Baba's leaving the mortal coil. Leaving their dishes, they ran to the masjid and found that Baba rested finally on Bayaji's lap. He did not fall down on the ground, nor did he lie on his bed, but sitting quietly on his seat and doing charity with his own hand, threw off the mortal coil. Saints embody themselves and come into this world with a definite mission, and after that is fulfilled, they pass away as quietly and easily as they came. Bo to Sri Sai. Peace be to all.